So thank you everyone for being here today. I'm very happy to see you, that you've arrived. A couple of things to talk about. Number one is, some of you may know this already, but our Kickstarter campaign went over the threshold yesterday, so we got over the $23,000. Yeah, yes, thank you. Well, and it's mostly you to thank, because I know many of you have been backers, and I really do appreciate that. And we have four more days to go, and we'll see if we, and there's still more donations coming in, so that's very encouraging. I also want to remind you that you can learn everything you want to know about this series by going to whomyoulove.com, where you can see about next week's talk, where Simon LeVay will be talking about his studies of differences in the brain between gay and straight men, reported way back in 1991. And he's also quite the scholar of this area, and so I can assure you, you'll find his talk interesting. And let's see. No. So today, I'm very happy to introduce Dr. Meredith Chivers, who will be talking to us. It could easily have gone the other way. Meredith, I think, could easily have been a neuroscientist or someone studying learning while other kids were just watching their hamsters. She was busy letting them run mazes in her house. She has very, very lenient parents, I think. They trusted her. And she's, you know, teaching them how to run a maze and timing them to see how quickly they could complete it, et cetera. But as an undergraduate, she got interested in, she took a class in human sexuality that she thought was just gonna be an easy A. I guess it probably was an easy A.
I got a B.
Never disagree with the professor is my advice at a class. But whatever the grade, it kind of changed the course of her career, and I'm awfully happy that she did. She would eventually get a Ph.D. from Northwestern University, working with Michael Bailey, who's another one of our speakers that's coming in the weeks to come. And then she spent a couple of years working at the Center for Addiction and Mental Health in Toronto. And in 2009, she got her current position in the psychology department at Queen's University. And so I'm she's gotten a lot. She's been a very productive scientist. She's very well published a lot, and she's also gotten a lot of media attention. You might have read about her research in the New York Times Sunday magazine just last year, I think. And I know you're going to find this interesting, so help me welcome, please, Dr. Meredith Chivers.
Am I on? I'm on.
Oh, yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. So this is a note to everyone. Don't take human sexuality as a bird course. It doesn't work. So despite the B, I did end up continuing on to study sexuality. And when Mark invited me, thank you for the invitation, by the way, to come and speak, I was delighted to be able to come and talk about women's sexual orientation, and though I know the series very much focuses so far on individuals with same-sex attractions, if we as scientists are going to try to understand the biology and psychology of sexual orientation, we also have to understand what's happening with straight sexuality. And so today I'm going to present to you sort of the body of research that I've done on women's sexual psychophysiology and how this body of research really has started to show that of all of them, straight women seem to be the queerest of all. So a bit about sort of what I do. I'm a clinical psychologist by training, as Mark alluded to. I did do a brief stint of comparative psychology research as a child, studying my own hamsters. I think I was always an experimentalist at heart. But I've been really fascinated by this research question, which is, what is the relationship between the mind and the body in women, in particular in the arena of sexuality? And so this is a question that I've looked at in a number of different ways. So my research program examines, you know, some of the questions I'm going to talk about today. So what this relationship is in the context of direction of sexual attractions. I'm also interested in this as a fundamental gender difference, this mind-body relationship, and I'm also interested in what the meaning of this relationship is for women's sexual functioning. But like I said, today I'm going to talk about this relationship in the context of sexual orientation. So what I want to talk about I want to first talk about sexual psychophysiology, get everybody sort of on the same page of how we do this kind of research, and then start to talk about what the research looks like in terms of gender and sexual orientation differences in sexual psychophysiology, in particular, the kinds of differences we've seen with respect to women's and men's sexual attractions and how this fits into a broader picture of how women and men's same-sex attractions manifest, how they develop, and how they express themselves. And I really want to talk a lot about what sexual arousal means. And in public forums like this, I really like to take the opportunity to try to educate people because about what these different variables mean, because I think that there can be a misconception that when we study a physiological parameter, for example, like genital sexual response, that this in some way represents truth. And indeed, in this sort of circuitous path I've taken in this line of research, nothing could be further from the truth. And as you'll see, the picture gets pretty complex. So what is sexual psychophysiology? So essentially, this is a study of the psychological and physiological aspects of sexual response and the interaction between these components. And so in our lab at Queen's University in the Sexuality and Gender Lab, what we do is we essentially focus on two components. So the physiological changes that are associated with sexual response, and this generally refers to what's happening with people's genitals when they're getting sexually aroused. There's certainly other physiological changes that happen when people are becoming sexually aroused that generally reflect amping up of the sympathetic nervous system. So these are non-specific or not exclusively related to people becoming sexually aroused. But genital responses, so increases in blood flow to the penis that results in penile erection, increases of blood flow to the vulva and the vagina, which leads to clitoral erection and vaginal lubrication. These are all specific to sexual responding. And so in women, we, in my lab, have used a device called a vaginal photoplethysmograph. So this is a picture. Not to scale, of course. This ruler here is put in, I believe these are in inches, yes, because this was my American photo. If I put it in centimeters, people might be a little confused. But this is, to give you a sense of the size of this device, so this is, it's like a tampon-shaped probe. It's about the size of a super-size OB tampon. Inside this acrylic plastic is encased a photo source that light illuminates the walls of the vagina. And then depending on the amount of blood that's in the tissue in the vagina at any given moment, changes the amount of light that's reflected back and picked up by a little photoresistor that's also embedded in the plastic. So a woman can insert this into her vagina herself in a private room. And if you're wondering, this piece of plastic right here is just a placement device. It controls the depth and the orientation of the probe inside a woman's vagina. So this is an example of the signal that we get from the vaginal photoplethysmograph. And so if you're looking up here at this red signal here, you see what looks almost like a pulse waveform. And so each of these pulses represents the amount of blood that's being forced through the vaginal tissues with each heartbeat. And so this is the vaginal pulses of a woman who is just sitting and resting. Those of you who are curious, this line down here is a plot of this amplitude of every single one of these pulses. And when we show a woman a sexual stimulus, this might be a little bit hard to see, but you can see that the amplitude of these pulses increases, and it's very nicely demonstrated by this plot here in the yellow line of the change in those amplitudes. And so that's what we're measuring when we're assessing vaginal vasocongestion in women. We're measuring changes in light reflectance. So this is a picture of one of my graduate students just to demonstrate what it looks like in our laboratory. People come in and sit in a really comfortable chair, usually not wearing pants, but this is my graduate student after all. They sit and they either listen to audio sexual stimuli, so stories that describe sexual interactions, or they would watch sexual stimuli displayed on a monitor. And in this photo, she's using a keypad to answer questions that are presented both before and after each of the sexual stimuli, and would also use that to self-report feelings of sexual arousal. So to measure men's genital responses in research laboratories like mine, commonly use penile plethysmography. So same principle, you're measuring changes in vasocongestion associated with penile erection. We use this device, a penile plethysmograph, and this is essentially like a small rubber band that a man opens and fits around the midshaft of his penis, and it measures changes in the circumference of the penis as he develops an erection. This is an example of a signal from a penile plethysmograph. So this is a female sexual stimulus that he's listening to, and this line right here represents changes in his penile circumference, so I'm going to guess, probably with very good accuracy, that this is a straight guy. As he's developing an erection, listening to an interaction with sex with a woman. So that's, those are two ways that we can measure genital vasocongestion. There's a bunch of other different methods that are available out there, but these are methods that have a lot of data supporting their reliability and their validity, and are also fairly straightforward for our research participants to use in the lab setting. Assessing the cognitive and emotional changes is relatively straightforward. What we're asking for is people to report their subjective state of feeling sexually aroused. So there's a couple of ways that we've done this. When I was a graduate student at Northwestern University, Mike Bailey and I built this box right here it's kind of like a drive shift that people would continuously manipulate as they were watching a sexual stimulus. So the full forward position would represent the arousal they'd associate with having an orgasm, and full back would be not aroused at all, and they would manipulate this as they were watching films. In my lab now, what we've done is to have people report how they're feeling as they're watching a film or listening to a story. We have them use a keypad to manipulate a virtual gauge that's presented adjacent to a stimulus on a TV screen or on a TV screen itself. We also ask people to complete a series of self-report items, both before and after the sexual stimuli, asking how sexually aroused they felt during the film. So this is just trying to access their affective state. And we also ask people about their perception of their physiological responses, so how strong were your genital sensations during the film. So before I continue, I want to go through a couple of definitions of terms that I'm probably going to toss around quite a lot during the rest of this talk. I'm going to talk about something called the specificity of sexual arousal. And so what I mean by this is a category-specific pattern of sexual arousal would be one where someone shows significantly greater sexual arousal to stimuli that match their sexual interests. So these would be preferred sexual stimuli. So an example of this would be a gay man showing significantly greater penile responses and self-reporting that he feels more sexually aroused by sexual stimuli that depict men. This is different from something I'm going to refer to as non-specific sexual arousal. So this is a pattern where a person shows significant increases in sexual responding to both their preferred and their non-preferred sexual stimuli. A pattern that you'll see comes up again and again when I'm talking about heterosexual women. Now, for the purposes of this lecture, when we're talking about sexual orientation, sort of in its general use, where we think of sexual orientation as your sexual interest in men and women varying along that gender dimension. But we've also looked at sexual interests or orientation in terms of both genders, interest in different sexual activities, and as well as age. But I'm going to be focusing in on the gender component this afternoon. So thinking back to when I started this research program, one of the questions that really fascinated me and has continued to fascinate me throughout all of this research is to try to understand how it is that people go out and select their sexual and romantic partners, because we don't do it randomly. We all have some set of criteria that we want to meet when we go out and find a sexual partner. And so myself and other researchers think of sexual orientation as kind of like a compass. It's something that directs our sexuality towards particular kinds of categories of individuals. And so when we're talking about sexual orientation, these individuals vary with respect to their gender, whether they're men or women or some degree in between. And so in trying to answer this question, so what is it that our sexual orientation orients? One of the possibilities is that it's our sexual arousal responses. So if something turns us on, and in turn getting turned on by something motivates our sexual interest, then perhaps that is one of the factors that becomes oriented when we talk about somebody's sexual orientation. Now, when I first started doing this this work, when I was actually just finishing my undergraduate degree, there was very little that was known about patterns of sexual responding in women. But this man, Dr. Kurt Freund, who was then still alive and working at the Center for Addiction and Mental Health, had done extensive amounts of research in the context of forensic psychology, and so trying to predict patterns of sexual offending among men with dangerous sexual interests. He had looked at the relationship between these men's sexual preferences and their patterns of sexual responding in the laboratory as a means of getting an objective measure of their sexual interests. That was when I was there, which was in the mid-90s. But prior to that, he had done extensive amount of research looking at the relationship between men's sexual interest in women and men and their patterns of sexual responding in the laboratory. And so in this figure here, I've reproduced some data from one of his papers from the early 70s showing men who are sexually attracted to women and men who are sexually attracted to men and their penile responses to either female sexual stimuli here in the blue bars or male sexual stimuli here in the yellow bars. And so, I mean, it's fairly straightforward and obvious. These men are showing significantly greater penile responses to the stimuli that match their self-reported sexual interests. And so this pattern had been sufficiently replicated with respect to men's gender preferences, and it was Dr. Freund who then extended this to look at men's activity preferences and age preferences and so on. But when I came on the scene, I asked him, I said, so Dr. Freund, how is it that you've never studied women? So what do we know about this relationship with respect to women's sexual interests and arousal? And I'll never forget this quote because that had such an impact on me. He said to me, Meredith, I am a man, how am I to know what it is to be a woman? Which was a very poignant statement. He was pretty much saying to me, how am I supposed to begin to understand this area of research when intuitively I don't have any connection to it? And so this really got me interested in answering these questions with respect to women's sexuality, through what the relationship was between women's pattern of physical sexual responses and their self-reported sexual interests. And the research that existed at the time was pretty sketchy. It was inconsistent. There were a few studies that had suggested that there was a very strong relationship, very similar to what we might see with men. So women who self-reported that they were sexually attracted to women were showing significantly greater genital responses to women than to men. Those studies were published in the early 80s. And then there were some contradictory data that had just very recently come forward in the mid-90s that suggested that women's sexual responses were indistinct. And so the jury was out. It wasn't really clear whether women showed the same kind of pattern of responding that we see with men, which I'll describe as category specific. And so I began a program of research that I started as a graduate student at Northwestern University in trying to answer this question. And what I'm going to show to you now are a couple of slides which are actually from some of the postdoc research that I did at the Center for Addiction and Mental Health, which really nicely summarize where we're at with respect to understanding women's sexual response patterns. So in this study, what we had done is recruited women from the community in Toronto, and so these were women who reported either predominantly other sex attractions or women who reported predominantly same-sex attractions. Before I go on, I just wanted to make a note. I don't use the terms heterosexual or lesbian throughout this talk, and there's a reason for that, which is that I think, especially when we're interested in understanding the relationship between sexual attractions and patterns of sexual response, I don't want to confuse what I think of as sexual orientation, so the direction of somebody's sexual attractions, with somebody's sexual identity. So an identity being, for example, describing your sexuality as a lesbian, describing yourself as queer, or as bisexual. And the reason that I don't do that, particularly with respect to women, is that there tends to be a degree of heterogeneity in women's sexual attractions within each of those categories. So what I mean by that is that it's not uncommon for a woman who would describe her sexuality as being lesbian to report some degree of other sex sexual attraction, or maybe she's had some sexual experience with men. We can't infer just from her self-identity label that she is only exclusively sexually attracted to women or that she's only ever had sexual experiences with women. If anything, that's usually not the case. Okay. So we recruited these women from the community in Toronto, had them come into our laboratory, and we did a sexual arousal assessment where we showed these women a bunch of different videos that depicted stimuli that varied by both the gender of the people depicted and the kind of sexual activity that they were engaging in. And so we had films of men and women engaging in naked exercise. So we had men doing nude yoga and walking on a beach, and women doing nude aerobics, ostensibly for all those nudists out there who really want to exercise in the buff. Or I suspect for people who were just too shy to actually go out and buy porn, so they had to buy naked aerobic videos instead. Then we had videos of women and men alone engaging in a sexual act, so they were masturbating. And then we had depictions of couples engaging in sexual activity. So the reason that we had created these sexual stimuli that varied by gender and the degree of the sexual activity was that that previous study that I mentioned earlier that had shown that women were not discriminating in their genital responses to these different films showed films of couples engaging in sexual activity. And so we supposed that perhaps one of the things that was driving that response was that we were kind of showing these women these really intense films of couples getting it on, and that we were sort of maxing out the genital response system. And then if we dialed back the intensity of these films, that we might begin to see some discrimination in their sexual responses. So here I'm going to walk you through the data that we collected from the predominantly other sex attracted women. So I'm going to orient you to this figure. We've got women's genital responses here. This is in a standardized score. And these are the responses to female stimuli. So these are female exercisers, masturbators, and then two women engaging in sex. We have male stimuli here, so male exercisers, masturbators, and two men having sex. And then we've got a comparison with a neutral stimulus. This is just films of pretty landscapes with music. And then a film of a man and a woman engaging in sex. And so what you'll notice here is that there's a sexual activity effect. So as the sexual activity becomes more intense, the amount of genital responding increases. But there's, among these other sex-attracted women, there's no differentiation by gender. So they're not showing significantly greater genital responding to the male sexual stimuli, which is what you might expect if this corresponded with their stated sexual attractions. Compare this to what we found with the predominantly same-sex attracted women. So what we were finding here was that among these women, there was a significant relationship between their self-reported sexual attractions and their patterns of genital responding. They were still showing this sexual activity effect. They were still showing more genital responses as the intensity of the sexual activity went up. But they were showing significantly greater responding to the female than to the male stimuli. Just as a note, we did replicate what other studies had found. And if you look just at the red bars here, there was no significant difference between their genital responses to the films depicting couples for either the same-sex attracted women or the other sex-attracted women. So it wasn't until we showed these solitary individuals either nude and exercising or masturbating that we began to see this differentiation in women's genital response patterns. So what we were seeing here was both a gender difference and a sexual orientation difference in the specificity of sexual arousal. So we knew that there was lots and lots of evidence that men's sexual arousal, both their genital responses and their self-reported sexual responses, were category specific for gender as well as other categories. But what we were seeing was that among these other sex or heterosexual women's responses, they were non-specific. And whereas these same-sex attracted women were showing a category-specific response that was similar to what we were seeing with men. And so what this suggested to us was that these sexual arousal patterns didn't seem to be oriented to gender in other sex-attracted women in the same way we were seeing with same-sex attracted women. But we were seeing that their genital responses seemed to vary with the intensity of the sexual activity that was shown in these videos. So we asked the question, well, maybe sexual activity matters more than gender for women's sexual response systems. Maybe variation along that sexual activity, both preferred and non-preferred sexual activities, might have more of a bearing on whether women experience a genital response or not. So then we asked the question, what kind of sexual activity seems to matter more for women's sexual response? And so for this next study, we were really curious as to whether we could see a genital response from women to non-preferred sexual activity from non-preferred sexual partners. So we wanted to create a sexual scenario that contained all of the features of sex, but there was absolutely no plausible sexual partner. And so what we did is we created a film that depicted bonobos engaging in copulation. So this is a picture of a male and female bonobo engaging in intercourse. I took a nature documentary and spliced together 10-second segments, that's how short their little bursts of mating are, spliced these together and created what was called in the New York Times magazine bonobo pornography. Mixed in some ape sounds to make it seem more realistic. There was previously narration over top of all of this. So essentially I created a sexual stimulus that depicted non-humans engaging in sex that looked very human-like to see whether or not women would show a genital response to this. And indeed, we did find that what happened was that women, and in the initial study they were other sex-attracted women, did show a significant genital response to the depiction of the bonobos engaging in sex. It wasn't as large as what we saw to the human depictions, which were longer and much more intense. Humans, thankfully, tend to mate in longer than 10-second bursts, so I think that might have had something to do with it. But indeed, we were seeing a significant difference in women's genital responses to seeing the bonobos having sex than to a neutral sexual stimulus. Which years later prompted this. It was a few years ago that one of my students pointed out to me that this was circulating on the internet. And as flattered as I was that a summy card had been devoted to my research, it also really pissed me off because this is sort of the fundamental misinterpretation of these data is that somehow our physiological responding is truth, and what women say they're attracted to or what they report is something that we can ignore. Nonetheless, it's still rather entertaining. So continuing along this line of research, so now we're looking at this dimension of sexual activity. Does preferred or non-preferred sexual activity activate this genital responding in women that doesn't necessarily tend to correspond with their self-report of feeling sexually aroused? So in this study, my now postdoc, Kelly Sashinsky, looked at women's sexual responses, both their self-report and their genital responses, to depictions of sexual threat. So these were movies that depicted women experiencing a sexual assault. So they were taken from commercially available films. And then compared this non-preferred sexual activity with consensual depictions of two men, two women, and a man and a woman engaging in sex. And so what she found, which replicates other studies that have looked at women's genital responses to depictions of sexual assault, was that there was no significant difference between this. So what seemed to matter more was whether or not there was a depiction of some kind of sexual activity in the film. So here are women's genital responses to a variety of stimuli that are evoking different affective states. So this is a neutral film, one that evokes feelings of happiness, sadness, exhilaration, and anxiety. You can see that there's no significant difference here, but as soon as we introduce sexual content, there's an increase in vaginal responding. Which led us to speculate that perhaps preferred sexual activity doesn't even matter for women's genital responses either, that this genital responding just seems to be an automatic response to depiction of any kind of sexual cues. though I'm not presenting the self-reported feelings of sexual response with each of these slides, the patterns look very much like a category-specific pattern. So these are, in Kelly's study, these were heterosexual women, so they reported their most feelings of sexual arousal to the male-female stimulus, and then very little responses to these non-preferred sexual activities and non-preferred couples. So we wanted to pursue this question a little bit further, because one of the things that these studies lacked was a group of individuals who actually preferred a different kind of sexual activity. All of the women who were in this study ostensibly did not prefer sexual assault over consensual sexual activity. We needed to have a study where we had two different groups of individuals who preferred different things. And so we recruited, this was a study we conducted a few years ago, and the study's under review right now. In Toronto, we had recruited women with and without interest in sexual masochism. And so sexual masochism, as some of you might know, is an interest in being dominated or humiliated. This is a consensual sexual interaction that women have with their partners. And we wanted to look at women's genital responses to stimuli that depicted both conventional sexual interactions, so consensual sex between genital sexual interactions between, for example, a man and a woman or a woman and a woman, versus those kinds of interactions that would include masochism, so where would describe a female or a male dominant forcing the participant to submit to, for example, receiving pain or humiliation. And so I'm going to show you in this figure women who reported no interest in sexual masochism, their genital responses to these different categories of stimuli. So they listen to neutral stories, so ones that describe people going to the laundromat and doing laundry together. They listen to descriptions of sexual masochism, either with a male or a female dominant who was administering the pain or the humiliation. Then we had stories that combined that sexual masochism with some degree of a sexual interaction. So sexual interaction might describe, for example, forcing the participant to perform oral sex on the dominant. And then we had women listen to stories describing conventional sexual interactions with a man or with a woman. And what you'll see in this figure is that these women were showing significantly greater genital responses to the conventional sex categories. Again, remember, these were women who didn't have a sexual interest in masochism, than the masochism in sex. And so we were actually able to show that these women were showing significantly greater genital responses to a preferred sexual activity. This would be a category-specific kind of pattern of arousal. What's interesting about this pattern, though, is that if you look at their responses to just the depictions of pure masochism, they were still showing significantly greater genital responses to these descriptions of receiving pain and humiliation than to a neutral stimulus. So even though there were no frank descriptions of sexual interactions or genital interactions or descriptions of a sexy person, what we suspect is that the sexual context that most people understand masochism to occur in was enough to initiate this genital response in women. I'm not going to present the data from the female masochists, but I did want to highlight one thing, which is I'm just showing you data here that are averaged across the male and whether the dominant was described as a male or a female. And the reason I'm doing that is that even with this non-preferred sexual activity, the gender of the person didn't matter. So for these women who reported that they had no interest in sexual masochism, it didn't matter whether the dominant was described as a woman or whether the dominant was described as a man. What I couldn't find a better dominant than that on the internet, at least one not as sexy as this. Gender of the person described didn't matter with respect to women's genital responding. What seemed to matter more was whether the sexual activity described something that was preferred or not. Contrast this with women's self-report. So here we've got all of those categories of stories that I've described. This is the change in their self-reported sexual arousal. The yellow, the orange is the responses to the female stories. The green is the response to the male stories. And again, these are women who are predominantly other sex attracted and who report no interest in sexual masochism. And so what you see here is that they report that they're more sexually aroused by the male stories than the female stories consistently. And that the sexual activity also matters. So again, you're seeing this difference between the self-report of feeling sexually aroused and women's genital response patterns. So an interim summary. So what we seem to be seeing is that among women who are opposite sex attracted, their genital responses are non-specific with respect to gender. They respond to both male and female sexual stimuli, though they report that they're more sexually attracted to men. And we see more of a category-specific pattern of self-reported sexual arousal. So women are reporting that they're more turned on by the stimuli that correspond with things that match their sexual interests. We see variation in women's genital responding with the intensity of the sexual activity and with preferred and non-preferred sexual activity. And so this led us to suspect that this genital responding that we're seeing in women, which seems so diverse and nonspecific, is just an automatic protective response that is provoked by any depiction of sexual activity, whether it's preferred or non-preferred. But we were interested in looking at another dimension of these sexual stimuli. People have speculated, researchers have speculated that context seems to be more important with respect to women's sexuality, especially relationship context. And so we wondered if we began to manipulate the relationship context within which these sexual acts were described, if that would have any bearing on women's sexual responses. So the data I'm going to show you from the next study were collected both in Toronto as well as in Kingston. We created a series of narratives describing sexual interactions with a man or with a woman, and the relationship context of that sexual interaction differed. So we had three categories, one that described a sexual interaction with a long-term partner, so somebody who was described as a boyfriend or as a girlfriend, and it was very clear that there was a long-term romantic relationship there. We had individuals who were described as intimate long-term friends, so somebody that you had a close relationship with, but where there was no prior sexual relationship. And then a category of people who were complete strangers, so it described two people meeting up and having a sexual encounter without there being any relationship context for that sexual encounter. So these are the data for women's genital responses. And so what we had thought might happen is that we might see an amplification of women's sexual responses to female stimuli in the friend condition, suspecting that that warm connection and bond with a woman might facilitate genital responses pursuant to some theories of, for example, Lisa Diamond's about women's same-sex attractions emerging within the context of close friendships. Instead, what we got, and I see a few people smiling, in the audience was a completely unexpected effect where women showed their highest genital responses, though this is not significantly different from a long-term relationship, highest responses to the stranger sexual stimuli, followed by the long-term relationship, and then the lowest responses were to the friend category. Now, I have to emphasize that these stories were carefully written so that they included the exact same description of the same kind of sexual act, where the same kinds of sexual words were used in the same number of them, and the onset of the sexual interaction was controlled so that it was happening about the same time. So we tried to control these stories as much as possible. But what we see here is, first of all, gender doesn't matter. These were opposite sex attracted women. Their genital responses did not differentiate significantly between the female and male stimuli, but what mattered was the context. And so I suppose the take home message is that trying to be friends with a woman before you try to engage her in a sexual relationship is not going to be a great strategy, something that most people probably already know. But in trying to wrap our heads around this, we thought about who are women's close friends In some cases, you know, you've got groups of individuals, especially, you know, if you're talking about people who could be ostensibly possible sexual partners. Close friends may represent a category of individuals who've already been assessed for their mate value or their mate potential, and they're in the no category. There is still a connection with that person. There may be an intimate relationship, but it may not be sufficient to ascend to the level that somebody's going to have a romantic and intimate relationship with them. Now let's look at their self-reported responses, because we see a complete reversal. These women are reporting that they're more turned on by the male stimuli. They're still reporting some increase in their feelings of arousal to the female stimuli, but what's really striking is that their genital response patterns, self-reported response patterns, don't differentiate by the relationship context condition at all, but we did find it with their genital responses. So we thought this was a fluke, of course. As a good scientist, you say, I don't believe my own data. So we collected another sample of women in Kingston. We replicated the same thing. Then I thought, okay, something's really weird about my stimuli. Like, we recruited a male sample. We found a category-specific effect with the men, so they were showing more arousal to the female than to the male stimuli, and we didn't get the relationship context effect. But we're trying to, at this point, wrap our heads around what information we can get from these friend stimuli, for example, that might give us some clues as to those factors that are associated with women experiencing a genital response versus not. So, up to this point, a lot of the research that we'd conducted had focused very much on other sex-attracted or same-sex-attracted women, leaving out a whole category of sexual attractions in the middle. And Alice Draker, who's going to be coming to give a talk, when's Alice going to be here? December 3rd. Alice is going to come to speak, and she's a great speaker. I hope you guys can make it out to talk to her. Published this article last March in the Atlantic magazine, which was a wonderful title, Are Straight People Born That Way? And in this, she really begins to put under the microscope an aspect of, you know, sexual orientation that's rarely examined, which is straightness. You know, if we're going to develop a theory of, you know, the biology and psychology of sexual orientation, we better explain how it is that people can be straight as well. And one of the questions that she highlights in this article, and which was really brought to the fore in some recent research that we did, was that, you know, being straight or identifying as heterosexual doesn't mean that people aren't attracted to the same sex, even just a little bit. So it doesn't mean that you are only attracted to the opposite sex. And this got then picked up by Dan Savage. I don't know how many of you are Savage Love listeners. And he riffed off this, and his comment was, straight people, WTF. Which at the time was kind of fortuitous, because it really corresponded with some of the research that we were doing, looking at response patterns in women across this continuum of same and other sex attractions. So have we seen the Kinsey, has the Kinsey scale been talked about yet? Really? Okay, in passing. So some of you may have heard about the Kinsey sexual attraction scales. So these are developed by Alfred Kinsey as a means of assessing relative same versus other sex attractions. So an individual gives a zero score if they report that they're exclusively other sex attracted, and a six if they're exclusively same sex attracted. And so in research where people look at, you know, people who are heterosexual, or they designate individuals as lesbian, for example, they're usually averaging together individuals who have predominant other sex attractions and women who have predominant same sex attractions. In our lab, we were really interested to know to what was happening in the middle of this scale. So women who were reporting some degree of both other and same-sex attractions, what did their sexual responses look like? Well, you'd expect that they'd probably be some degree of arousal to both male and female stimuli that would somehow, you know, correspond with their self-report of their sexual interests and attractions. We were also really curious to understand what was happening at this end of the scale, because like I said, not all straight people are entirely straight. A lot of people who describe their sexuality as straight also report some degree of sexual attraction to the same sex. And if you look at the data, looking at the distribution of same-sex attractions, particularly with respect to women's sexuality, there's a real gender difference in the distribution of these. So these red bars represent distribution. These are percentages here of women. And the blue bars are distributions of men. And these are non-zero Kinsey scores. So these are individuals reporting some degree of same-sex attraction. And what you'll see is that the percentage of women who are reporting some degree of same-sex attraction, though they would probably identify as heterosexual, is significantly larger than what we see with men. And also that there seems to be this unimodal distribution of these same-sex attractions among women, whereas in men, there tends to be this bimodal distribution. Most of the men are congregating at the ends of the Kinsey scale. And so we were really curious about, you know, it's not depicted here in this slide, but what is happening in that 0-1 transition where you have women who are reporting, I'm not sexually attracted or interested in women at all, versus those women, these women right here, who would say, yeah, I have a little bit of same-sex attraction, but I still think of myself as a heterosexual woman. So what we did is we recruited women in Kingston who reported some degree of same-sex attraction, had them listen to those audio narratives that I described earlier that varied by whether the person was a man or a woman that they were having sex with. They also varied by the relationship context. And then we pooled all of the data that we had representing all of the women across this degree of same and other sex interest. And this is what their genital responses look like. So these are the women here, Kinsey zeros, who reported, I'm sexually attracted only to men. I'm sexually attracted mostly to men, but a little bit to women. I'm sexually attracted to both women and men. I'm sexually attracted predominantly or exclusively to women. And so these people represented in this part of the figure, these are heterosexual women. But if you look at their response patterns, these women who are reporting that they're exclusively sexually attracted to men are the ones who show the most nonspecific pattern of sexual responding. They're not differentiating by gender at all in their genital responses. And then as women report that they've got some degree of sexual attraction to women, their pattern of response differentiates in the direction of more arousal to women and is sustained across the self-reported sexual attractions. And responses to the male sexual stimuli similarly go down. So these are heterosexual women, like I said, probably the queerest of the whole group. If we look at their self-report is somewhat more in line with their stated sexual attractions. So these women are reporting that they're more turned on by the male than the female sexual stimuli. But these women who, again, are reporting, these are heterosexual women who are reporting some degree of attraction to women, are reporting that they're about equally turned on to the male and female stimuli. So a surprising pattern that we didn't expect. So how do we understand this? One of the possibilities that often gets posed is the potential that we're looking at responses that reflect a methodological artifact, that there's something in the way that we're measuring genital responding that's different between women and men, which is why we're getting this nonspecific pattern in women. So the way that we measure genital vasocongestion in vulvas and vaginas doesn't equal what happens with penises. So I think that it's definitely worth investigating. But we've also seen that this pattern of gender nonspecific responding has been documented with a variety of different methodologies. So looking at brain responses to processing of sexual stimuli, you see heterosexual women showing this nonspecific pattern again. Another way of doing imaging of brain activity, magnetoencephalography, same story. You look at cognitive processing of sexual stimuli, so a visual attention to sexual stimuli, you get the same pattern in heterosexual women where they attend about equally to both male and female sexual stimuli. And most recently, Gerhard Frieger and Rich Savin-Williams up at Cornell published a study looking at pupil dilation as a measure of sexual interest. And same thing again, heterosexual women don't differentiate by gender. Everybody else, queer women and gay men and straight men, everybody else is showing a differentiated pattern. So I really don't think that this is methodological artifact. I think, in fact, we're onto something that's pretty interesting and that spans multiple ways of looking at processing and attending to sexual stimuli. So one other possibility is that there's a gender difference in the way that sexual stimuli are being interpreted. And so the cues that are being interpreted as sexual seem to be much more broad among women. Current theories about how these cues are activate sexual response suggest, however, that these cues acquire the sexual meaning through learning. So, quote from a recent paper, the quantity and quality of incentives or sexual meanings have the ability to activate the sexual system depend on an individual's sexual history. So this really suggests the sexual meanings that are associated with responding to different kinds of stimuli are learned. To which I've said, does that mean that other sex-attracted women then learn to become physically aroused to other women, to masochism, to sexual assault, to bonobos? It doesn't make sense. These women have not had these head sexual interactions with any of these scenarios in most cases, and probably aren't masturbating to thoughts of these, and so engaging in some kind of covert rehearsal of becoming sexually aroused to this. It doesn't fit. And so what myself and my colleagues have proposed is, and my postdoc in particular, she calls this the preparation hypothesis, or why genital arousal is so nonspecific in women. And so I've alluded to this earlier, that there tends to be this somewhat independence of the physiological responding that women experience and their self-report of feeling sexually aroused or their emotional state of feeling sexually aroused. And what we suppose is that this is a protective response, that having a sexual system that's very sensitive to cues of sexual activity in the environment, responding automatically to those cues, not having to elaborate and think about whether or not these cues are sexual, and having the body respond, that genital response initiates vaginal lubrication, and that lubrication is protective during intercourse. And the analogy that I make is that it's similar to when people who are vegetarian, for example, how many people are vegetarian in here? So a few of us. All right. So when you smell bacon, whether or not you salivate, and a lot of people say, yeah, I don't really want to eat the bacon, but the bacon makes me have this salivation response. And that salivation response is all about preparing your digestive tract to digest the food, to lubricate the digestive tract, and so on. And so we liken this automatic genital responding to the same kind of response. And so what this is a protective mechanism. It doesn't have any bearing on a woman's sexual motivation, her sexual interests, or her state of sexual desire. It's a response that's provoked that lessens the likelihood that she's going to experience any kind of harm in a potential sexual assault. So genital response is not sexual orientation in women. And at least among other sex-attracted women, it looks like physiological arousal is not being oriented, and as I said, these results converge with other research using other methodologies. And this possibility is that this plasticity that we're seeing in women's sexual response system relates to the fluidity in sexual expression that we see among women. So Lisa Diamond has done research where she's looked at women's sexual orientation in a developmental context and looked at how women's sexual attractions and identities fluctuate with time. And other researchers have looked at the contextual plasticity of women's sexuality. So what that means is how responsive women are to shifting their sexual behaviors and attitudes as a function of the context within which they're expressing their sexuality. and suggested that women may have more plasticity in their sexuality. So one possibility that we're investigating right now is that this potential to become aroused to both male and female sexual stimuli may relate to this flexibility in sexual identity and self-expression of sexuality. We're doing a longitudinal study where we're just about to collect the second wave of data, and we want to see whether women who show a more non-specific pattern of sexual responding are more likely to show shifts in their sexuality over time. So, with respect to understanding women's sexual orientation, though, the questions really begin to multiply. I mean, for myself, I've looked at these data. I've been doing this research for 10 to 15 years now, and really think that we need a different model to begin to understand why it is that we see these very different kinds of patterns of responding in the laboratory with women that seem to mesh with the different presentation that we see in women's sexuality. When asked the question, what does sexual arousal mean in the context of sexual attraction? I mean, the short answer is we don't really know what the link is between somebody becoming sexually aroused by something, whether that actually leads to them seeking out a sexual interaction. And in the context of studying women's sexual functioning, some have suggested that trying to distinguish between the state of arousal and state of desire, or state of sexual motivation, doesn't make any sense. That from models of incentive motivation, the two of those states might actually be the same thing. I often get asked, does this mean that all women are a little bit bi? And again, I come back to the summy card and say, no, we can't extrapolate from women's physiological responding and somehow say that what happens with people's bodies is more important than what they tell you. I think that women are showing a certain degree of flexibility in the response system, but it doesn't necessarily translate into them adopting a bisexual identity. Very recently, I went to see Naomi Wolf speak. She came to a writer's festival in Kingston. How many people have read her book, Vagina New Biography? So at the very beginning of her talk, she said that, I don't know whether this was a shout out to me in the audience or what, but she said, now there's research showing that there's no such thing as heterosexuality because women get turned on by everything. And to which I was shaking my head saying, no, that's not what it shows at all. Absolutely, there's heterosexuality in women. I think that we really need to be careful about extending evidence from a laboratory setting to trumping an individual's experience and expression of their sexuality. Some of my colleagues have asked, does sexual orientation even exist in women? Supposing that people's patterns of sexual arousal are their sexual orientation, and to which I come back and say, so how do you explain women getting turned on by all of these, with patterns of sexual response that correspond with preferred sexual activities, getting turned on by bonobos and so on? Absolutely, sexual orientation exists. It just may exist in a different way than what we understand it to be for men. And so, how does this relate to understanding the development of same-sex sexuality in women? Two of my colleagues, Lisa Diamond and Letitia Peplau, have talked about the fluidity of women's sexuality, so the capacity to shift and change over time. And Peplau has talked about what she calls an intimate careers model, the idea that the context within which these sexual interactions happen and these romantic interactions happen may be more important to women's same-sex sexuality than directional sexual attraction to either to men or to women. As far as how that relates to the kind of research that I'm doing in the laboratory, we'll have to wait and see how all of that plays out. So thank you so much for your attention. I just want to thank my laboratory, the Sexuality and Gender Laboratory, all of my students there, and the various organizations that have funded the research that I'm doing in Canada. And I welcome your questions.
I'm sure there are questions, and let me ask you to raise your hand so I can bring you the microphone so everyone can hear. Okay. And
First of all, thank you very much for a very engaging presentation. It was interesting and very informative as well. So I'm very particularly interested in how you are interested in women and so-called heterosexual women, mm-hmm. and how they are looking very queer indeed. And given the history of this study of, you know, scientific study of human sexual orientation that tended to be traditionally very much focused on male sexuality and homosexuality in particular, it's very interesting for me to hear your presentation today. And I just wonder what you see as the implication of your study that seems to sort of maybe reveal some limitations in the traditional way we thought that there are certain categories such as male heterosexuality and male homosexuality, and I use that as a sort of basic analytical tool in many cases in the study of human sexual orientation, especially among males. Do you see your kind of study sort of a sense that you can proceed as a parallel to this kind of study? Let's look at, you know, the part of human brain to see if there is any part, INH3, to take an example, that may be related to human male homosexual orientation. But it looks like your data seems to complicate that kind of approach in itself. So I just wonder if you can comment a little bit on that issue.
Sure. So absolutely, one of the problems with finding that women's patterns of responding don't differentiate is that if you take these women and put them into a brain scanner, you're probably going to see the same kind of pattern. And indeed, some of my colleagues have found that. We've done subsequent research, which I both speaks to the sexual orientation issue as well as some sort of a broader issue I'm interested in, is sort of how is it that sexual stimuli acquire, you know, their meaning and significance. And so I actually cut these slides because I knew I was going to go over time, which I kind of did, so I'm glad I cut them. But we actually took this a step further and said, well, what if we've looked at the effect of context, of relationship context, we've looked at the effect of sexual activity. What if we strip everything away and we just show people pictures of genitals? So the reason I did this is that a colleague of mine in Germany had done a brain imaging study where they showed images of sexually aroused genitals to men and women of a variety of different, you know, same and other sex attracted, and found a pattern where of what we call specificity, even among the heterosexual women. We thought, well, that's pretty neat. What if we looked at their genital responses? And so when we showed women pictures of just erect penises or exposed vulvas of women who were visibly sexually aroused, so their vulva was engorged, they looked lubricated, we actually did see a pattern of category-specific responding in these heterosexual women, which really suggests to me, what I think is really fascinating about that is it suggests that all of these other contextual details, all this other information that's being communicated in a sexual stimulus of the partners coming together, of the physical characteristics of the individual's description of the scenario, seem to be sufficient to activate a sexual response in women, which seems to be pretty different from what we see in men.
I got here a little late, so you may have covered this, but what about the relationship between the subjective response of males and females? So, for example, for a male, to become erect is arousing in and of itself, I believe, and for a female, it's less so, and that would be perhaps an explanation why Viagra isn't used widely by females, and I wonder how that might impact what you talked about.
Sure, absolutely. So I'm really interested in this phenomenon as well, which we call sexual concordance, so that relates that bind-body relationship. And a few years ago, myself and colleagues had published a meta-analysis, so a quantitative review of the sexual psychophys literature, looking at this relationship between genital responding and self-report in women and men. And we sort of quantified this gender difference, showing that the agreement is much stronger in men than it is in women. And so certainly what we're seeing here is sort of an extension of that mind-body disconnect phenomenon. What I want to highlight, though, which was really interesting about those data, was that among the women, there was so much variation in the degree of that agreement. And so we had women who showed perfect agreement to no agreement whatsoever to almost negative relationships. So, you know, that degree of variation in that mind-body relationship really suggests that there's other factors at play. But among men, there seemed to be much less variation. And indeed, this, you know, I've talked about using pharmaceuticals to augment genital responding in women as a way of treating, for example, sexual arousal problems, and why this probably doesn't work. So Viagra was tested in women back in the late 90s and the early 2000s, and several of my colleagues were involved in those drug trials. And what was really fascinating about the Viagra trials in women is that they worked in the sense that they actually increased genital vasocongestion in women, but it didn't result in any appreciable change in their feelings of sexual arousal. So it became a really expensive placebo in some ways. You could use, you know, a lubricant just as effectively. What was even more interesting about those data is what seemed to matter more was women's expectancy. So if they believed that they had taken Viagra, whether they had or they hadn't, whether they were given a placebo or the active drug, they reported that they felt more sexually aroused. So what mattered more was their belief in whether they had received the drug. And so, there's been a great degree of pharmaceutical involvement in trying to find the Viagra equivalent in women. And I've suggested that an agent that's going to act solely on amplifying physiological response is unlikely to work.
I wondered what you'd found over the lifespan of women and how much age is a variable.
With respect to the pattern
sexual
of
sexual arousal, mm-hmm. and, yeah, panadrines.
So the research that I've been reporting on looks at women usually between the ages of 18 and 45. We have yet to start looking at women over the age of 45. With respect to genital responding, certainly women who are going through a menopausal transition or who have gone through menopause do show lower genital responses in the laboratory. I mean, this is related to decrease in estrogen, and estrogens are very important for the maintenance of vaginal tissue and the maintenance of the vasculature that causes that vasocongestive response. But with respect to this specificity, non-specificity phenomenon, we haven't got there yet. So. But stay tuned.
One problem, you need more women over 45 who are taking introductory psychology. Right?
Well, you've answered one of the questions I had. The other question I have is about attitudes or cultural attitudes about sex, mm-hmm. and perhaps the females buying into the idea that you're not supposed to be sexually expressive.
Sure.
That this is kind of repressed, mm-hmm. By religions and many cultures and so on. And it probably is very difficult to study. However, I'm wondering if your research or other scholars have looked at social attitudes toward sexual behavior in women and the possible relationship that might have.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's a great comment. Of course, all of this happens within a sociocultural context, and for women, you know, the message is pretty consistently women aren't supposed to get turned on. They're not supposed to look at sexy pictures, and you're certainly not supposed to tell people when you're turned on either. So it probably comes as no surprise that a lot of this research is based on a biased sample. It's not everybody who says, yeah, I'll stick a probe inside my vagina and watch some porn and tell you how turned on I am. So we do consider that in our research, that we're kind of looking at the upper end of women who are really comfortable with their sexuality. Even though that's the case, we have just very recently looked at an attitudinal dimension that reflects how forthcoming people are in their self-reported responses, something called impression management, and looked at how it relates to women's self-report of feeling sexually aroused. And we were interested to know whether women who were doing that continuous monitoring through the films, so they're reporting how turned on they felt as they were watching the films or listening to the stories, we wanted to know whether that was more related to this impression management or whether they, when they were asked after the story or the film, that was related to impression management. And what we found was even among this sample of, you know, very select, very, you know, sex positive women who come into our lab, there was still a significant relationship between impression management and their self-report of feeling sexually aroused, but only when they were doing it after the film had ended. So one way to think of it is that when you ask women to report how they feel in the moment, there's so much going on. They're looking at a film, they're manipulating a lever. They don't have the opportunity to sort of reflect and maybe have those sociocultural biases influence their responding as much. And we're about to look at the data for women's physical responding as well and see whether there's any relationship with impression management.
It seemed like there was a question on this side. Yeah. So,
here. Excuse me.
Thank you. I loved your lecture.
Thank you.
I was interested. Did you have some of your subjects that would come in and report, self-report, I have no interest in other women ever? And then were they told that they had genital arousal? And were they surprised? Or
so
how did that work?
Absolutely. We had women who came in and reported, I'm not sexually attracted to women. We also had women come in and say, I'm not sexually attracted to men at all. And they would show genital responses to so their non-preferred category. So usually what happens after any of these studies is we debrief participants, we tell them what the purpose of the study is, and I also would offer to women, I'd say, if you want to see your responses, I'm happy to show you. But we never made it sort of part of the process. But I definitely did have women who said, yeah, sure, I want to see that. So they would come into the room where we operate all these computers, and I would show them their responses, and some women looked at it and said, I'm not surprised. Mm-hmm. This doesn't really conflict with what I know about, you know, my body's responses. And I asked a few of the women, and I said, so how does this fit with your feelings of sexual desire and interest? I said, well, that's not what it is, though. It doesn't feel like that. You know, my body might be responding, but it doesn't necessarily mean that I want that, or
right,
that I'm going to go out and have sex with women, or I'm even going to go home and download some porn with women in it. But yeah, that turned me on.
Yeah, that's interesting. Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
While I move the microphone, one of the things that occurs to me is that, I mean, it's kind of interesting that to the extent that the same-sex attracted women show a more differentiated response, that in that way they're acting more like men, right?
Yes.
That's because men also show a fairly well-differentiated response. And so I wonder if you think that in some sense there's something masculine, or at least something masculine about having more differentiated genital response in women. Might that reflect some masculinization?
Well, that's one possibility. So, you know, if you try to fit these data within, for example, neurohormonal hypotheses about the development of sexual orientation, the idea that, you know, having same-sex attractions is a departure from what is typical of your biological sex. I think it could work as long as we're willing to accept that among heterosexual women that becoming turned on by both women and men is prototypical of heterosexual women, and that differentiation is what is indicative of departure from that. I think one thing that's I wonder sometimes is who are these heterosexual women who report some same-sex attraction? And so last time I saw Lisa Diamond, I asked her, I said, so who are these women? Are these queer women in waiting? Are they just going to come out? Is that, you know, they just need some contextual event in their life, or a little bit more time, or whatever, and they're going to, these are going to be, you know, queer women. She said, I don't think so. But she never gave me a good answer. But she's going to come to Kingston in a few months' time, and we're going to sit down and look at some data together. So I might get a straighter answer out of her.
Yeah.
So I know that your data shows that there is some degree of disconnect in heterosexual women between genital arousal and what they do desire and what they do want, sexually speaking, you know, in a partner and whatnot. Has there been any study into what the causes of those desires are? If it's disconnected from genital arousal, at least to a degree, has anybody been studying what it is that is actually connected to what women want, mm-hmm. if they're heterosexual?
It's a great question. The short answer is no. We tried this and it's not working. So back to the drawing board of trying to understand the factors that are associated with what it is that women desire. I mean, some researchers who have less of a biological approach to this would suggest that, you know, all women and all men are raised within a heterosexual context, and that there really isn't any choice per se. It's that everyone is expected to follow this heterosexual path. And so perhaps it's all those sociocultural influences, those messages that you should be attracted to men, you should be sexually satisfied with men, that this is the way your sexuality is going to develop, might be one path. But I think we know very little about the factors that contribute to both same and other sex attractions.
I think we have time for two more questions. I see here and there, and so hold on.
I was just wondering if there was anyone in your study that was using hormonal contraceptives because of that effect on libido and whatnot.
It's a great question. So we have in the past included women who were both using and not using hormonal contraceptives. But we very recently completed a study where we looked at the relationship between where a woman was at in her menstrual cycle and patterns of sexual responding to male and female stimuli. So I had a very smart graduate student who said, well, maybe what's going on here is that we've got women who are oral contracepting as well as naturally cycling women at various stages of their menstrual cycle. And then if we only looked at women who were fertile, maybe these heterosexual women would show more arousal to male than female stimuli. Great hypothesis, not supported.
And also sort of fits in with your protective hypothesis.
Yes. That the, yeah.
Okay, one more question.
Yeah, I had two curiosities about your lecture. The first is I was wondering if you're willing to tell us what you consider your own personal orientation.
Okay.
Or not.
I don't identify as heterosexual.
Okay. And the other thing is that I got the impression that men were much more likely to not respond to male porn as women are. I mean, it just seems to me that men would be less likely to do that. Does your research show that?
So that's often how it's interpreted, that it's sort of all or nothing for men, and that's really not the case. And so we often see that men will show some degree of penile responding to non-preferred stimuli, but in general, I mean, what we're seeing is vastly larger sexual responses to what's preferred than non-preferred.
So that's greater in women than in men, right?
Yes. So
it's
more of a difference of degree than it is of kind. It isn't that men don't respond at all to non-preferred sexual stimuli. It's that women show much greater responses to non-preferred than they do.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Yeah, and so thank you. And thank you, everyone, for your attention.